We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
How are you?
Frank.
It's been a long time, Ruslan.
Yeah, it's
no,
been
it really long. Hasn't. Yeah. We just saw each other last week. But we are coming out of our summer break.
Yes.
And we are live with you once again after a couple of months.
At LA Talk Live.
On
Cool Classics. Classics.
Here at LATalkLive.com. So we're happy, happy that you're all here, and I'm sure you are. I can feel you through the miles throughout the world here listening to us. So we're going to have a wonderful guest today.
Yes.
So what have you been up to?
Boy, Frank, it's been a busy summer.
I know. We've been together a lot.
Yeah.
We've done a lot of these busy things together. Yeah.
Concerts, performances, trips.
Yeah,
just got back from Germany.
You were in Germany, yeah.
Yeah, for
How
2 weeks.
Oh,
wonderful. It was excellent. Yeah. Brought new shoes.
I think you showed them to me.
Yeah, they're on my Facebook.
Our audience has to one of these days see his brand new shoes. They sparkle like many of the stars in the firmament, don't they? I haven't seen them live yet.
You will. You will. Don't worry.
Okay, maybe at our next show you will have them here at your live shoes on LA Talk Live. Yeah, oh boy. They are beautiful. Yeah, and I've been busy. You know, one good thing happened. Many good things happened. I produced Madame Butterfly. Both out in my festival at Redlands Bowl and here at Marina Del Rey at the concerts. And, of course, we've done concerts there.
Yep.
We did a concert in Lake Arrowhead together. We did a concert
at the Redlands Bowl. With fireworks.
With fireworks.
That was a magnificent show.
Yeah, your shoes would look great for, for that.
What did you do?
They would have been splendid. But also, I'm really happy to announce, since we are here in L.A., that our music festival at Marina Del Rey for the third year running has been voted the best of the West Side.
Congratulations.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Oh, there's
amazing.
Our audience. Thank
yes,
you.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Yeah, we're very excited about that, and it means a lot to us because we've been there for 17 years, and for the past 3 years, we've been voted the best cultural event and the best concert series on the West Side of Los Angeles. So thanks to all of the people that are supporting that. And also, I want to thank Beaches and Harbors of L.A. County, and also Supervisor Don Canabi, who has been the sponsor of that. He will be termed out this year. He'll be moving on to other things, and there'll be at the election, there'll be another supervisor. But he has been instrumental in making that success.
Yeah.
And you've played at that too.
Yeah.
I think it bears mentioning.
Yeah, truly wonderful, wonderful concert.
So what did we started with this wonderful piece.
It was Vivaldi's summer, and this is the end of the summer.
I know, we have only a few weeks left.
Unfortunately, yes. Yeah. But we are still sort of in that summer kind of.
It's coming back.
Yeah,
audience.
Yeah,
it's
going to
be hot again the next couple of weeks.
Yeah. And we are having, you know, we are stepping out of our normal show routine today because we have a very special guest.
Special guest, yes.
And this guest will stay with us within the entire show.
Right.
And ladies and gentlemen, I'm really, really proud to introduce Mr. Mariusz Brimora, who is the Consul General of Poland in Los Angeles. Consul Brimora is a graduate of Faculty of English of Maria Sklodowska-Curie University in Lublin, Poland, and he holds a postgraduate diploma in British Culture and History from Warsaw University and Ruskin College, Oxford, in England. He speaks English, Polish, Russian, Italian, four languages altogether, and obviously is a very smart and interesting individual, and we thought that we will spend with him the entire show.
Wonderful.
Because it's a really,
a lot
really
to say.
Interesting. Yeah, so that's Mr. Right. Brimora, welcome.
Thank you very much.
And tell me if I forgot to mention any of your, you know, anything about you, because your bio is pretty big. So,
all you said is true. I am at the Consul General of Poland in LA. I'm a career Polish diplomat. I have been one for 17 years now. 17 years ago, I joined the Foreign Service. Before that, I was into local politics in my local town of Radom in Poland, in the middle of Poland. And even before that, I pursued my academic career teaching students in Poland for about 15 years. So that's
what did you teach, Mariusz?
I taught English, okay. And I taught also British and American studies, which is a very interesting course for future teachers of English, teaching them about contemporary Britain and contemporary America. When we talk about America, was anything from the presidential system and presidential elections to Andy Warhol.
Okay, wow. So a big palette there, range. Yeah. Wonderful. And you've been in Los Angeles now how long?
3 years.
Oh, that's short.
And you oversee, wow, what, 1.2 million?
I've been here for 3 years, but this is my third posting in America. Right. I started my career in Chicago, which is a number one American city for all Poles, mm-hmm, because of the huge Polish community over there. So I came to Chicago in the middle of September 1999, which was my beginning of my diplomatic career. Spent 4 years there, went back to Warsaw for less than 2 years. Came back to Washington, D.C. to serve at the Embassy of Poland in Washington, D.C. for a full 10 years of 4 years. I returned to Warsaw again, this time for a longer time, for 4 years. And in 2013, I came here as the Consul General.
Good. And you like it here in Los Angeles?
Of course I do. How can you?
I didn't want to lead you wrong on that question.
How can you not like California?
Isn't it wonderful? I know. It's a great.
How
place.
Many Polish people live in United States now, approximately?
It is only seemingly a simple question because, of course, it is difficult to count ourselves, especially in today's world where people travel so freely and they change places because of the job contracts, mm-hmm, they get and so on and so forth. The data that we have is only an estimate number. It's based on the American census, mm-hmm, and the last census that included the question about ethnic identity was the census of the year 2000, and it returned the number of 9.3 million people of Polish descent who live in America.
Well, that's a significant number.
Yeah.
You need to remember that Poland is a country with a very complicated and a very tragic history, and that was the reason why many Poles at different periods of our history had to leave Poland for various reasons. As a result of all that, we are the country with one of the biggest diasporas, that is, mm-hmm, the Polish community outside, living outside of Poland. Mm-hmm. The estimate is that up to 18 or even 20 million people of Polish descent live somewhere outside of Poland.
Now that brings up a question. Poland is a nation of about, what, 38, 40 million people?
Yes, it is. The current population is almost identical as the population of California, 38.5 million.
Right. And you're a country of about, what, 120,000 square miles, something of that nature?
Probably you are right, although I would prefer square kilometers, 512 square kilometers.
All right, we'll go to your system. That's fine. But so it's a little bit smaller in geography than California. This gives people a tiny bit smaller.
Yes, that's, mm-hmm, that's true. You know, one needs to realize that there are American standards and European standards, mm, as far as size is concerned, mm, and size of the countries as well. So in American standards, Poland is a rather small country. It is 5 times smaller than Alaska itself. It is smaller than California. It is even smaller than New Mexico, I believe. If I remember correctly, it is 11 times as big as Hawaii Island.
Right,
yes. But in European standards, it is a much
bigger
country.
Of course,
it's
absolutely.
It ranks ninth in Europe as far as area, mm-hmm, and eighth as far as population.
And Poland is a member of European Union.
And Poland is a member of the European Union. It has been a member of the European Union since May 1st, 2004, when, together with 9 other countries, we entered the European Union.
Mm-hmm. Very interesting. Very interesting. Well, the Poland is probably the only country, as far as I know, that at certain point had a musician being a prime minister or the president of the country.
You are right. You must mean Ignacy Jan Paderewski.
Exactly.
He's a great pianist.
Yes, I call him the best pianist among prime minister and the best prime minister among pianists.
That's indisputable. I think we'll agree with you on that.
Paderewski was the prime minister of Poland in 1918 for slightly less than a year, but it was a hugely important time for Poland because it was the time when Poland regained independence after 123 years of partitions when Poland was swept away from the map of Europe.
Wow.
And Paderewski actually was very instrumental in Poland's regaining independence. Mm-hmm. He was a very well-known artist in the world. He was also a very well-known politician. His personal friends was President Woodrow Wilson, and he was working with President Woodrow Wilson in the process of Poland regaining independence. So that famous speech that President Woodrow Wilson gave at the House in Washington in January of 1918, in which she called for Poland being re-established mm-hmm. as a free nation with mm-hmm. an access mm-hmm. to the Baltic Sea, was also some of the that we need to give credit for that to Mr. Ignacy Jan Paderewski, and he became then the prime minister.
So we have recording here of Paderewski, Polish prime minister, playing Polish music. It's a Polonaise by Frédéric Chopin. Why don't we listen for it right now?
Wonderful.
And you guys will have an opportunity to hear how prime ministers can play piano. And we are back at Folk Classics.
Really interesting to see. I had asked Ruslan when this was recorded, because it's a very clear recording, so I imagine it was fairly late, like mid-40s or something.
Yeah, probably. Well, I think he died in the beginning of the 40s, so probably at end of 30s.
Yeah,
it's a Paderewski died in June of 1941, as far as I remember. Yeah. You know, this was an unbelievable man, so we could probably devote a whole separate show to Paderewski. But when he died in New York, and then his body was transported to Washington, D.C. on an open carriage on a train, and it was taken to the embassy of Poland. Thousands of people came to pay tribute to Paderewski when his coffin was in the embassy of Poland in Washington, D.C. And at that time, because of how important he was for our country and this country, at the special request of the President of the United States, a permission was given to bury Paderewski at Arlington Cemetery, even mm-hmm. though he was not a citizen of the United States. Mm-hmm. Paderewski, supposedly before he died, he said that he would love to return to Poland, but only when Poland is free again. And he had to wait quite a while for that to happen, because when in 1989 Poland regained independence after the Solidarity victory at our country, at the beginning of 1990s there was a special committee in Washington DC under another very important guy and Paderewski fan, General Ed Rowney, who was in his life a security advisor to five American presidents. And General Ed Rowney was the chair of the special committee which arranged for the body of Paderewski to be transported to Warsaw, which eventually happened in 1992. However, the heart of Paderewski, yes, remains in the United States.
See, this is interesting. The hearts of Polish people, you know, Frédéric Chopin, and we had this little conversation before, right? Heart of Frédéric Chopin traveled to Poland, yes, from
exactly,
France.
Exactly.
What is it there with Polish people and their hearts, you know, traveling and being all over the...
No, no. We are talking about two most special people. Frédéric Chopin, the biggest Polish composer, and Ignacy Jan Paderewski, who, as we said, was a politician, a statesman, and an artist. And it is true that their lives were so complicated that Chopin left Poland as a very young man and never returned to Poland. He spent most of his life in Paris, and he died in Paris, and he was buried in Paris. But the love of Chopin for Poland and the love for Frédéric Chopin was so great that his heart was taken to Poland and is in one of the churches on Krakowskie Przedmieście in the heart of Warsaw.
Wow.
With Paderewski, it was the other way around, because the body of Paderewski was transferred to Poland, but his heart remained here at Doylestown in Pennsylvania, a place which is called an American Częstochowa. And Częstochowa, again, is a special religious place in Poland for every Pole, because it is the site of the Black Madonna, the most important religious place in our country.
This is interesting, too. One of my greatest mentors was from Doylestown and retired to Doylestown. Virginia Borton, remember her from the Marina concerts?
Oh, yeah.
She loved Doylestown. She had lived here in Los Angeles for like 20 years and was a producer for concerts. She retired in Doylestown and died there, so I have some connection there. Tell us a little bit, I think, since we're on the subject of Paderewski, he has some important California connections.
Oh,
also.
Absolutely.
Yes.
That's another great story about Paderewski. I believe it was in 1914 when he first came to California. At that time, he already had some arthritis problems, and he came to Paso Robles, a place that most of Californians know, if not for music, then for wine.
For wine, yes.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And Paderewski discovered that the hot springs in Paso Robles were helpful for his hands, for his arthritis. So he liked very much coming there, and he came, returned over and over again. He eventually bought a range over there called San Ignacio. He started his own Zinfandel called Paderewski, and Paso Robles became a very special place.
And that was kind of a new introduction of a wine grape, was it not?
Yes, at that time.
Yeah, right,
exactly.
Yeah, yeah,
exactly.
Yeah,
you're
yeah,
right. Yeah. So I'm proud that until this day we have a very tight connection with Paso and with the people over there, not necessarily of Polish descent, with many, many American friends as well. And we hold a Paderewski Music Festival each November over there. In a few weeks from now, we will have another music festival over there from the 3rd until the 6th of November. It is usually the first week and the first weekend of November that we play the Polish music over there, where they have a contest for young players. It is done in connection with the Polish musical institutions and with kids in Kuryłówka in Ukraine today, where Paderewski was born. And so kids in Ukraine have their own contest, and they come here to play at Paso every second year. Yeah. And young people, mm-hmm. young students from California go to Poland and to Ukraine every other year to perform over there.
This might be a good chance for us to tell our listeners here at LA Talk Live about this Paderewski Festival. This is something they might want to attend, and also because you go to the wine country, Paso Robles is very beautiful, and at that time of the year it'll be special. Now, how can they find out about the Paderewski Festival or the
I mean, the easiest way, of course, to Google the Paderewski Festival.
Absolutely. They have their own web page, and there is always information at the consulate about this, and we will be posting the detailed program, schedule of the Paderewski Festival, and they can always reach also the Polish Music Center at USC here in LA, which is a partner with Paso to organize Paderewski Festival over there. So there are at least three sources.
Wonderful. You know, while preparing for this broadcast, I actually found myself being somewhat surprised and almost stunned to find out how the extent and the degree to which Polish government supports the arts and promotes the arts. I mean, the CD set that you gave us and this wonderful block of Polish classical music of 20th century published on major labels. We are talking about Deutsche Grammophon, Universal, EMI.
This one yet, good. Great.
We'll play some of the music from it right now. It's truly remarkable. Truly remarkable. And in this sense, maybe we could announce also two concerts that Polish consulate sponsors at LACMA, which are coming up very, very soon.
I'm glad to hear what you say, because this CD box was done at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs when I was working there before coming to work in California. It is an example of what the Polish Ministry of Foreign Affairs does as in promoting Polish culture. And of course, the music of Chopin and Polish music, classical music in general, as well as Polish jazz, are fantastic means of promoting Poland. So we did a few boxes like this one, presenting the music of Chopin and other Polish composers. And yes, the consulate and all Polish diplomatic and consular missions all over the world are involved in promoting Polish culture. We here in LA as well. And as you mentioned, Ruslan, there are two concerts coming in LACMA in the Sunday Life series, that musical series, classical music series that LACMA does. I'm very pleased with the cooperation that we have with LACMA, which I developed after I came here with Bill Vestal and that series. So in a week and a half, the following weekend on Sunday, September 25th, we will have two Polish pianists, Anna von Urbans and Kordian Gura, playing a special repertoire of musical pieces arranged for four hands for two pianos. And then in the middle of October, that is October 16th, we'll be hosting one of the very renowned Polish pianists, Ewa Pobłocka, who is visiting America and visiting LA with her two daughters. As I said, Ewa is a pianist, but her daughters, one of them is a cello player and the other one is a soprano. So it will be a special program of Polish music, starting with Chopin and Paderewski, including the songs written by Chopin and Paderewski, which will be sung by Maria Leszczyńska, the daughter of Ewa Pobłocka. But this program will include also contemporary Polish music by Lutosławski, by Grażyna Bacewicz, and other Polish composers.
And the both concerts are at 6 p.m. in LACMA at the Bing Theater.
Yes.
It's Wilshire and Fairfax. They are free of charge.
Yes.
And they are broadcast live via LACMA website, and then will be later podcasted on KUSC, as far as I know. So, guys, attend it. Listen for it. Really great, interesting opportunity. Why don't we listen right now for Polish anthem? Okay. Which, if my research is correct, it's essentially a mazurka. Is it correct or no? It's called Mazurek Dąbrowskiego. Is that correct?
Yes, the Polish name of that anthem is Mazurek Dąbrowskiego. Uh-huh. And you're right, as far as the genre, musical genre is concerned, it is a mazurka.
Why don't we listen for it right now?
Well, that's a spirited national anthem.
I mentioned before, Poland lost independence in 1795 as a result of the third partition of Poland. We lost independence for 120 plus years. And 2 years later, 2 years after the third partition, this song was written in Italy to give encouragement to the soldiers of the legions of General Dąbrowski to fight for independent Poland by Józef Wybicki. This song was written in Italy in 1797, and it gained a special place in the hearts of Polish people. In the 1920s, it became the official anthem of Poland.
So it's been the official anthem starting 1927. Okay. During the Second World War and the Soviet period, it remained.
There were tries to change. There were trials to change it under the Soviet regime, but it was a failure. The Mazurek Dąbrowskiego has always been the Polish national anthem.
Just an interesting question, because we have this issue with our own national anthem, and I conduct the national anthem almost ours, obviously, before almost every concert. And people are very respectful of it. They stand and, you know, they love it. They always wait for the high note at the end. You know? They're just waiting. Oh, wow. Do the Polish people, in general know how to sing this national anthem?
Of course they do.
Good.
Of course they do, although it's a different piece of music than yours. Yours is, I believe, it's a more of a solo piece for solo artist.
Right, yes.
That's why this high note at the end and all this.
It doesn't have to be done with the high note at the end. But
has a lot of interpretations, kind of.
That's
and
correct.
It's
allowed by law. That's a thing.
And it's, yes.
It's allowed by...
Yes. Whereas this is a different piece of music based on our folk music, as much of Polish music is.
Yes.
Like, for example, the music of Frédéric Chopin is said to have all these sources
in the folk
music. So this is... it has not such a variety of performances, interpretations as in the case with the American.
It's very spirited. I love it. I mean, I was not familiar with it. I haven't heard it before, so I'm delighted to hear it on our show here on LA Talk Live.
Yeah, when I was thinking which pieces to include today's program,
it's wonderful.
Once I heard it, I thought, we definitely have to have it. It's a very, very special song.
Now, who wrote the words? Where did the words come from?
Józef Wybicki. He is the author of the word. That's the guy who wrote it in Italy in 1790.
Okay,
so has the language changed since 18th century? The Polish language, has it? The actual language, because with many other languages, like even English, you know, the English of Shakespeare and English of, you know, that what we have now, it's two pretty different things. You know?
Yes, every language develops, every language changes over the course of time. Same with the Polish language. The original version was slightly different as far as words are concerned, but only slightly different. But if you look at the Polish language of the Middle Ages, that obviously is a striking difference between the Polish language at that time and the Polish language today. Also, there are dialects across Poland. You know, if you go to the mountains or to the Silesia region or to the Kashuby region, you will be able to hear a dialect of Polish, which sometimes is close, but sometimes is pretty far from what the language that you would hear on television.
Very interesting. And just to kind of preset, guys, you will hear, you know, the Polish people have a profound musical culture starting from pre-Renaissance times. And we have a recording here of a piece by Mikołaj Gomułka, who was a Renaissance Polish composer. You will hear it in the second half of our broadcast today, hopefully, if we have enough time. Remarkable, truly, truly remarkable. Very, very interesting.
Something that always interested me, and our listeners, I'm sure, would be interested to know, the Polish culture, not that we know today so much, but when we see the first recognition of a Polish entity emerging, would you say in the 10th century, the 9th century, when did that happen?
Probably
when did it emerge?
When the Poland became Poland.
Poland,
like, recognized as
a country, came into existence in the year 966.
Okay.
That was the time when the king of Poland, Mieszko, accepted Christianity, and this is where the story of the Polish statehood started. So we can definitely talk about the Polish state since that time.
But Polish people are Christians, and is a dominating religion now in Poland?
Oh, absolutely. You know, when I travel around America, and as you heard, I came here 17 years ago for the first time, so I had numerous occasions to, and that's something that I love doing, is meeting students at different universities and talking to them about Poland. One of the things I try to make them realize is the huge difference between the American society and the Polish society. The American society is probably the example of the most diverse society you can imagine. Mm-hmm. As opposed to this, the Polish society is probably an example of the most homogeneous society you can imagine. 96% of the Polish people are ethnic Poles. So
here's a question for you then. It's a tough question. Why? Polish people don't accept other nations in Poland?
No. You know, the
historically just happened that way.
America is a nation of immigrants, so they came from everywhere here. It's a melting pot, as we know, and so on and so forth. it was completely different. We were always on this land. We Poles were always on the land that we have today. And the minorities are really minorities in that part of the.
I think it's truly remarkable, Frank, when I think of it. Poland surrounded with what? Russia, Germany.
Russia,
I mean,
Belarus,
it's really
Belarus,
whole bunch of
Slovakia.
Do you feel influence of other Czech cultures on the Polish culture, or Polish people happen to maintain the root of the culture, you know, in spite of being surrounded with all these pretty powerful cultures?
Yes, but we are also a powerful culture. So we had always had our own culture. Mm. It is. The whole region, we can talk about the Slavonic mm-hmm. nations mm-hmm. and Slavonic mm-hmm. regions. So there are similarities between these nations as far as culture, as far as language is concerned. But each of these nations has their own culture and preserved their own culture.
This also brings up something. When the Christianity was accepted, was there in the region a dominant language? Or was the acceptance of Christianity from Rome, or was it from the Eastern Catholic Church?
They already spoke Polish language.
The language
was there. Yeah. And this year, Poland celebrates 1,050th mm-hmm. anniversary of accepting the Christianity, and there was never a question of a different language being spoken there. So it was from the very beginning the tribe that became the Polish nation.
Listen, the time is flying
fast.
Oh
my goodness.
Yeah.
Oh, is it time for a commercial break?
Next? No, well, we still have one more.
Oh, we have, okay, great.
Why don't we listen right now for the piano concerto, the third movement by Andrei Jagodzinski, right?
Are we going to the jazz concerto?
Yes, that's a jazz
concerto. Oh, it's very good. It's very good.
Andrei Jagodzinski.
Here we go.
Yeah, it's a very good piece.
Choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Hi, this is Marsha Witeka, inviting you to join me every Monday at 1 p.m. for Born to Talk, where conversation plus connections equal community. Be sure to tune in to Born to Talk with Marsha Witeka, Mondays at 1 p.m. Pacific, exclusively on latalklive.com. You can also listen live at iTunes Radio R&B, TuneIn Radio, Radio Flag, Live 365, or AHA Radio. This is reality radio, handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. We are LA Talk Live, and we are born to talk.
Welcome, this is Greg, inviting you to tune in Saturday, 6 p.m. to the Mystic Ballroom. All vinyl most of the time, and we'll cover psychedelic, soul, garage, and much, much more. Myself and the Young Mogul. We're bringing you this every Saturday at 6 p.m. exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio, R&B, Live 365 Radio, Flag, TuneIn Radio, AHA Radio, TV Radio, and Apple TV Radio. Or you can watch, listen directly at LATalkLive.com. Reality radio handcrafted for yours and mine listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Good afternoon. We're back with Cool Classics
at LA Talk Live.
LA Talk Live. And that marvelous piece of drama, of dramatic music you're hearing, is by Lutosławski, the Polish composer, contemporary.
This is Symphony No. 3.
Wonderful.
Concerto for Orchestra. Yeah.
And we're, of course, here with Mariusz Primora, the Consul General of Poland here in Los Angeles, a very important man, a very important country, both to our relationship with Poland in the United States, but also culturally, which is, of course, the principal focus we're making here today. So, we hope you'll get to hear all this music, by the way, next week on our show
at 1 p.m.
At 1 p.m. here on Cool Classics, where you'll hear many of these things in their entirety.
I'm happy to say that this selection that you made is very special for me, because most of these are performed by my personal friends. We started the show with Vivaldi's Four Seasons, played by Mariusz Patyra, a Polish violin player, the only Pole who has ever won the Paganini violin competition in Italy.
Oh, wow.
Of course, Paderewski was playing Chopin. Then a minute ago, Andrzej Godziński Trio was playing Chopin in a jazzy way, which is a kind of new way of presenting Chopin, very popular in Poland and in the world recently. And Andrzej Godziński and his trio are very, very successful arrangers and interpreters of Frédéric Chopin music, and they are joined by Grażyna Augustyk, another artist who links Poland and the United States, because Grażyna is Polish, but she's a graduate of Berklee School of Music. She lives in Chicago, and she travels between Poland and the United States to give concerts of this kind, and she's been many times voted by Jazz Forum, a Polish periodical devoted to jazz. She's been voted a few times the Polish Jazz Vocalist of the Year. So she's a great artist too. So thanks for making this.
Why don't we take this opportunity to play right now? In fact, the Prelude in E Minor by Grażyna Augustyk.
Yes.
Right? Why don't we play it right now? And then we'll continue conversation about the famous Polish people.
Oh,
And we are back with Consul General of Poland, Mariusz Primorow, in the studio. Now, Mr. Consul, you are the co-author and editor of the book 400 Years of Polish Immigrants in America. And many people don't quite realize how many of prominent Americans happened to be Poles, right? Martha Stewart, and you continue there. The list, you know,
the list is the list is very long.
Robin Pillay, well, he's
very
Robin
very Pillay, briefly, the story behind this book is that the first Poles came to America in the year 1608. So only a year after Jamestown settlement was established, first five Poles came on one of the Captain Cook's ship to America, and in the year 2007, America celebrated 400 years. In 2008, we celebrated 400 years of Polish presence in America. And at that time, I was working for the Embassy of Poland in Washington, D.C., and we wanted to do something special to mark this occasion, and something that would not be just a concert this evening and then people will forget the next day about it, something that would stay. And we were lucky to manage to publish this book, which describes, just as an example, first 200 Polish names of the people who were somehow important in the life of America. The truth is, we discovered after years of working here as diplomats, that the knowledge of the American society about Poles is pretty shallow. They all learn at school about Pulaski and Kosciuszko, whose name they pronounce in a thousand different ways, and they know that these two were instrumental in the Revolutionary War and in the process of gaining independence by this country. But obviously, nobody realizes that so many famous people of contemporary world are Polish or of Polish descent. When I published this book and it started going to different places, and people would come back to me and say, "Hey, you know this book of yours? It's on my coffee table," and it and it starts huge debates when people come and see that Martha Stewart is Polish, that
Stephanie Powers
is Polish, and she spoke Polish with her mother at home. That Steve Wozniak, the co-founder of Apple Computers, is Polish. That the most famous basketball coach in America, Coach K, is Polish, and so on and so forth. That even talking about California, the man who brought California on the wine map in the world is Polish again. Warren Winiarski is a guy who at the beginning of the 70s quit his academic career in Chicago as a chemist, and he traveled with his family to California, bought a winery here, and only 3 years later his Cabernet Sauvignon won the famous Paris competition. And displayed in Washington at the museum in Washington as one of the things that America is proud of, and his wines have been served at the White House, and so on and so forth.
Wow.
So with this book, we just showed a little bit of the influence of people from Poland to the life and the culture of this country.
By the way, this book is filled for anyone who might be interested in it, if they can get a copy. I've enjoyed it since I received it a few weeks ago. And to see all the musicians and the artists, including Liberace.
Yeah.
Of course, we have to mention Liberace and many others. But it is really the book itself, done by our good friend here, the Consul General, is a treasure to see, and something that you would really, the printing, the text,
the quality of the paper,
the quality of everything within it, and it seems to follow very much, as I've now begun to see, including many of the Polish people that I have worked with in the musical world, starting with, I might say, an old girlfriend of mine many, many years ago who was of Polish descent, named Joan Zions, from Herkimer, New York, upstate New York. The quality of the cooking, the quality of the art, the quality of the person, and the incredible discipline the Poles seem to have, it really is amazing.
And speaking of the quality of the cooking, yeah. My question that I already asked once, Polish sausage that I love eating, is it, how Polish is it in the United States?
Oh, it depends where you get it. If you get it at the right place, it is a Polish sausage. But don't go to wrong places to buy something which is called Polish sausage.
How to identify that?
You have to call Mariusz Przybyła to find out where the good spots are.
We can always advise, but we'll not do commercial job here.
Okay, all right. Well, why don't we listen some more Chopin right now? It's the same exact piece that you guys just heard a few minutes ago. Now it's performed in its original version as Chopin composed it for the piano, Prelude in E minor. And we are back at Cult Classics at LA Talk Live.
That's beautiful. That nocturne is really, really, really gorgeous. Really beautiful.
Yeah, performed by Grigory Sokolov. Actually, yeah. He's Russian, and he was the youngest winner of international Tchaikovsky competition in the history of the competition.
Beautiful, beautiful sound.
I think he lives in Europe now, though. And, look, the next track on our rider here is the example of Polish music from the Renaissance period. Shall we just go ahead and listen for it?
Right, why not? Yeah, that'll take us back.
A nice contrast with 19th century.
Absolutely.
And why don't we experience the same Polish culture, but from 14th century? Actually, 16th. And you guys just heard a piece by Mikołaj Gomułka. He is the Renaissance composer of actually 16th century. And he was a member of royal court of Sigismund II Augustus, where he was a singer, flutist, and trumpeter. It's remarkable that the music actually survived, that the notation probably, you know. Now, tell us, if someone wants to visit Poland, where to go, where not to go, what to do and what not to do, very briefly, because we are actually running out of time.
I cannot be, it's difficult to be brief on that. There are numerous reasons to go to Poland, and that's what we keep saying here in America when we meet people. Culture is one of them, and we've discussed that a little bit, although there are many, many other areas of culture that we haven't touched today. Mm-hmm. But Poland is a fantastic business partner. Poland is a fantastic place to study, so we recommend for many, many people to go there and study. And Poland is a very geographically rich country, so it is, as we said, pretty small, but it has everything from the seaside in the north, where you can enjoy the sea and surfing and all this stuff, mm-hmm. through our huge lake district with over 9,000 lakes.
Oh, my.
To the south, where we have the mountains, so skiing is also something you can do in Poland. So a hugely interesting country. And in fact, whoever from here goes to Poland comes back impressed by what they see and experience over there. So, of course, I recommend to everyone, whether it's on business, whether it's to study, whether it's just to tour, as a tourist destination, I can recommend that.
Is the weather in Poland very variable through the regions as well?
The weather in Poland, I would say, is a good illustration of Vivaldi's Four Seasons.
Okay.
We do have them
four
all.
Seasons.
We do have them
something
all.
We're not that familiar with here. Yes.
Absolutely. Okay. And if you go there in January, it will it may be a bit harsh, because the temperature can drop to minus 30 degrees centigrade.
Wow.
In the middle of summer, it can be 30, 35 plus centigrade.
Now, here's a practical question. As a consul general, and our listeners are worldwide, they aren't just located in California, you see, do we need visas to get to Poland?
If you want to go to Poland as a tourist and stay there for a time of up to 90 days, you do not need a visa.
Wow.
If you want to go there for a longer time, if you want to work, of course, you would need a special kind of visa. But just as a tourist, just to visit, you can just book a plane and go.
Good. That makes it easy. So
yep.
There we go. Good.
Shall we move on with our...
Oh, what are we going to hear next?
Szymanowski, Violin Concerto No. 1.
Oh, wow.
And that's a contemporary piece.
Yeah, very much so. Very much so.
Yeah. And we are back on Cool Classics with the Late Talk Live and our wonderful, wonderful guest, Consul General of Poland, Mariusz Primora, in the studio. And we are getting close to our...
I know,
you know,
it's,
to the
it's
end.
Been a very fast hour, has it
very
not?
Very fast,
yes.
Yeah.
But we do hope that you will go to some of the concerts that will be occurring at LACMA, and you can look those up.
And to Paso for the Paderewski
and
Festival.
And especially, yes, for the Paso Robles Paderewski Festival.
And, of course, being where we are, we cannot fail to mention the film. You know, we are next door to Hollywood. So
yes,
another
yes.
edition of the Polish Film Festival commences on October 12th. at the Egyptian Theater in the heart of Hollywood.
Ah,
and
excellent.
We have it, that's an annual event, and we have it every year. And the position of Polish cinema in the world is stronger and stronger every year. So I'm proud to say that many film festivals, international film festivals in America, especially in the western part of it, that I work closely with, they always, every year, have Polish, they present Polish cinema. So whether it is the Denver International or Palm Springs or Seattle mm-hmm. International, they would always have Polish films.
They do it in Polish language, or it's subtitles?
They usually do it with subtitles. Yes. Mm-hmm.
So you see, there's a rich cultural to be explored here that many of you may not have yet done. The whole contact with Poland is a very strong one. Their arts are very, very prominent. So we do hope that you will look on every website to see where something Polish is happening, and it'll kind of fill your life with a whole new
perspective. And we promise you'll feel kind of surprised to find out what kind of people happen to be Polish people and Poles and what they have achieved.
And seeing on a constant basis, and have known, obviously, through my connection with many Polish artists and musicians, it's a very refined culture, and a culture that is now enjoying over 1,000 years of long life throughout our world.
Yeah. So. Time for Marcel Proust, our good friend.
Yes, our favorite. He has appeared. He has appeared as a guest on our show.
Yeah, almost every single time
for a year now. We'll have to be brief.
Because we are literally 1 minute.
All right,
left.
This is one I've never. What is your idea of perfect happiness? Or is there one?
I don't think there is one, actually.
You don't think there's one?
Yeah. Okay. Health and family are the two things
I think that's important.
That two things that I would put as number one.
I think that's a noble answer.
Yes.
Noble answer.
What is your greatest fear?
Fear of loneliness.
I don't think you'll ever be lonely, Mariusz. I
hope not.
I don't think
I hope
so.
Not.
No. You're too charming.
I remember these because it was my part when I was leaving secondary school and we were doing a theatrical performance. The character I played was saying this, that one of the things that we are afraid looking at the future, being a 19-year-old, is not to be lonely ever in your life.
Right. And I think that's a wonderful answer, and many people are always doing things too. And you know what? Your type of participation, both as a diplomat and apparently as a great, as wonderful scholar and a very appreciative arts appreciator and an active, you're not going to be lonely. Believe me.
Thank you.
LA Talk Live says no.
Here's another question.
Oh, yes.
If you could change one thing about yourself, what would it be?
No, I wouldn't change anything.
Good man. Wow. I think that's great. And how about this? This is what you didn't reject it, but. If you were to die and come back as a person or a thing, what would it be? You have that choice.
I wouldn't like to come back as a thing. Of course, I would
like
to come back as a person.
And what would
not any particular person. Right. I would prefer to stick myself, as I said. What else? You know.
Now you did say something earlier. You would like to be a musician.
Of course.
Okay.
But there are things that I wish I could have.
Yeah.
Like a talent for music. You know, there is a saying, they say that if you do not have a talent for anything, you become a diplomat. I don't think that's true.
True. I don't think that's true.
Definitely, one of the things I would like to do is to play the piano, which I cannot.
And you have a beautiful piano, so let me get started.
And the last question. When you die and you meet with God, what are you going to tell him?
My goodness. Here I am, God. Forgive whatever I've done wrong in my life. Here I am.
Ladies and gentlemen, it was Mariusz Rymora.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mariusz. We hope we see you again, and we will certainly be keeping our eyes open for all the wonderful cultural things that Poland has.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you very much.
And we will be back in 2 weeks.
Yes.
And you guys stay tuned next week for the full tracks of that, what you excerpts that you've heard today. Our next guest will be Caroline Sykes. She's an excellent
wonderful harpist. Yes,
yep.
Yes. Truly so you're hearing Ruslan and Frank and Frank and Ruslan, however it wants to be.
The cool classics.
On LA Talk Live, where the cool classics keep us posted on what's going on, and we'll keep you posted, and join us again at our next live broadcast.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for tuning in to LA Talk Live and the Talk Live Broadcast Network, original reality radio and crafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk. Stay tuned.